I'm Tracy Ellis, and this is the Elephant in the Dome, the official podcast of the Washington State Senate Republican Caucus. Homelessness and housing. The homeless population has exploded in recent years. At the same time, housing prices have skyrocketed. Senator Phil Fortunato is the ranking Republican on the Senate Housing Committee. He has a plan to tackle both that he calls homelessness to housing. He joins me now. Let's start with homelessness. How would you address that?
We had a series of bills that addressed each of the different aspects of homelessness. It's not one homogenous group. There is a series of different groups. And lately, we've just added another one, which is the homeless youth. So when you're looking at homeless, you have to say, why is this person homeless? Drugs and alcohol, mental health. That's a reason. But some of those people are also criminals. They're breaking into people's homes. They're robbing people on the street. Well, if they are criminals, they need to be incarcerated. Now, this is not a horrible thing to criminalize homelessness. They are already criminals. And we need to put them in, incarcerate them. And then that gives you a chance to address the drug and alcohol mental health issues. But you can't jeopardize public safety by being compassionate with a homeless person that's actually violent and breaking into your home or robbing your car. The next group are just drug and alcohol addicted mental health, maybe not criminals. Okay, those people need treatment. And that was to coincide with my Shelter Act. Now, the interesting thing about the Shelter Act is that was based on the model that has already proven to be successful. And there was a recent court ruling, Martin versus Boise, where the city of Boise tried to get homeless people off the street. Homeless advocates sued and said, you can't get them off the street unless there's a place for them to go. So the Shelter Act says, fine, I'm going to give you a place to go. Going to give you a tent, going to give you a sleeping bag, going to give you a security area. We're going to put a fence around it to give you security. I made the mistake of saying police presence instead of security in the bill. And then we are going to provide drug and alcohol mental health evaluation, but you're not allowed to have drugs. You're not allowed to have alcohol. So no drugs, no alcohol. If we're doing this at taxpayer expense, we can't take taxpayer money and then use that to subsidize their addiction. The Democrats opposed this because it was criminalizing homelessness, because they said, if we do this at taxpayer expense, you cannot then camp on public property, on sidewalks and public parks and whatever. If you do, it's a misdemeanor. We're going to send you to jail. There was outrage over this. Now, bear in mind, five other cities or more than that by now, city of Tacoma, for example, was highlighted for their innovative approach to removing homeless off the street, which basically implements the Shelter Act. And they were a $250 fine and 30 days in jail if you then camped on public property. So that's a way of getting these people off of public property, off the streets, out of the parks. The next group are what we call down and outers. Now, these are people that are sleeping in their car. They maybe have a job. They've had a series of bad things happen. And their car broke down. They lost their job, whatever it is. And then they find themselves evicted. And they find themselves homeless. But they don't want to be homeless. And those are the people that are actually the easiest to help. Because all they need is some time to get their act together. And we had a bill that was a graduated rent program, where the state would subsidize a program that your first 6 months of rent, for example, would be $300. That's what you would pay. The state would subsidize the rest. The next 6 months was $600. The next 6 months was $900. The next 6 months was $1,200. After that, you had to get off the program and make room for somebody else. Now, hopefully by that time, you would be able to pay the full rent on the apartment that you were currently living in. But that gives somebody 2 years to get their act together. But we also require them to be progressing. The other group is what we call recently homeless youth. And I was recently put on that committee and I said, where in the normal timeline are these kids becoming homeless? So an example is a normal family timeline is the kid goes to school, kid's in the family, kid goes to school, kid gets a job, you know, gets an education, gets a job, saves his money, and then moves out of the house. That's a normal timeline. So where in that timeline are those kids being disruptive? Is it maybe there's a family issue and they get kicked out of the house? Maybe it's an education issue where they don't have an education, they don't have skills to get a job that pays enough to be able to afford something. You know, they may need some kind of subsidized housing to, again, get their time, get that time to get their act together. So those are things that we need to look at. So now, and then the last group of homeless people are just people that are going to be homeless no matter what. I mean, there's always going to be this group of people that are going to prefer to be homeless. Well, okay, if you want to do that, you just can't do that here. You're going to do that somewhere else. And we as a society cannot tolerate this. This is, I mean, we want to be compassionate, but it's not compassionate to let people sleep in a cardboard box. And but by the same token, if we accept this, we will get more of it. And that's highlighted by the fact that we accepted it. And we are the number two state, I believe, in the nation for increased homelessness. The other side likes to say that the reason we have homelessness is because of housing issues. We don't have enough housing, et cetera. And that's why we have homelessness. And that's actually incorrect. I mean, the reason we have homelessness is this tolerance of drug and alcohol addiction. That's the biggest bulk of the homeless issue. And like I said, we have those down and outers. But there, if we look at the cost of housing, and I think that the housing industry has been doing this a little bit incorrectly because they have been highlighting the cost in dollars. That doesn't really communicate what the actual cost is, as opposed to the cost of a mortgage payment. What does it cost in your mortgage payment? So I have a bill I've been working on for, it's like 5 years now, you know, the American Dream Home Bill. And the object of that bill is to get government out of the way. You know, the Growth Management Act allowed for the imposition of impact fees. So now impact fees and building permits in some cases are $50,000, $60,000, $70,000. That's what government is charging before you even do anything. So a builder goes in and you know, you say, hey, I want to go in and build a house. They go, great, write me a check for $56,000. Well, what did you get for that? You didn't get anything for that. And years ago, before the Growth Management Act, cities and counties would zone things for single family or multifamily or commercial because they wanted the tax revenue, the property tax revenue. Now, all of a sudden, they can't do anything without imposing an additional tax. And that's all these fees are, is their additional taxes. So the American Dream Home Bill says, all right, let's get government out of the way. And let's take some of the programs that we are already doing in multifamily and for schools and things like that and apply that to a new home. And let's see what happens to the mortgage payment. American Dream Home says you can't have an impact fee, can't have a building permit more than $1,200. And then we're going to let the city keep the state's portion of the sales tax from the sale of the home. And that will help backfill some of those costs for the building permit. Now, that's based on Habitat for Humanity. So if Habitat for Humanity builds a house, the cities waive the impact fees and they waive the building permits. Well, let's do that for the private sector so that we can encourage the private sector to build a Habitat for Humanity house, because we need to be building 1,000 or 2,000 of these things a year. And you're not going to do that with Habitat for Humanity because they're building, what, 150 a year, if that. But that's the model. They have the model. And so American Dream Home is 1,700 square foot or less, no impact fees, no building permit more than $1,250. And then we are currently subsidizing apartments, and we are giving them a property tax break for 12 years if they have a portion of their home, of those apartments available to people making 80% of mean income. So you may be living in an apartment complex and you may be paying $2,000 a month, but the guy next door to you might be paying $1,000 because he fits into that 80% of mean income. But we're giving them a property tax break. So I said, okay, let's take that and let's give that starter home a property tax break. Let's exempt them from property taxes for 7 years. And we're building schools outside the urban growth boundary. Now, the reason we're building schools outside the urban growth boundary is because land is cheaper outside the urban growth boundary. Well, if we're building schools outside the urban growth boundary, we're putting in utilities and sewer and water and all that stuff for the school. Why can't we build these houses in that same with that same criteria? So now you can build these houses outside the urban growth boundary. So if you add up all of the savings from those programs, and we implement that, you're talking about a mortgage payment $600 to $800 a month less. How many people would be able to qualify for a mortgage if their mortgage payment was $600 to $800 a month less? That's a huge number. And what we are doing is, after 7 years, so you get that property tax exemption for 7 years, then after that, it goes away. Within that seven-year period, that house has to be sold to somebody making 80% of mean income, and that's based on the apartment criterion. But we're putting people into houses instead of apartments. And now that home becomes a market-rate house, and that person would then get the benefit of the equity of that house. Now, I asked builders, and you know, here's the biggest complaints. Builders would say, or they will say, builders won't build this. Well, I talked to builders, all the big builders. And here's why a big builder would do this. It's good PR. It's good PR for us. And we really don't care whether we build a $300,000 house or a $600,000 house or a $900,000 house. All we care about is making a 20% return on investment. So as long as they can make a 20% return on investment, they're going to do this. But the second reason they're going to do this is because people that buy small houses buy big houses. So we're missing this middle step. My wife and I just went out to look at, you know, hey, maybe we're going to look at downsizing. You know, we got a nice house. We haven't been upstairs in, I don't know, months. We only use about a third of our current house. So we went to look at, maybe we'll buy a smaller house. So we went into Enumclaw, $770,000 for an 1,800 square foot house in Enumclaw. I mean, holy crow, who could afford that? How are you going to go from an apartment, you know, where you might be paying $2,000 a month to a mortgage of $700,000? I mean, how are you going to do that? So we're missing that piece, and that's what the American Dream Home Bill does. Now, if you implement all of this stuff in a row, my goal is to get people to go from apartment to a house, American Dream Home. Then we want to move them from subsidized apartments to market rate apartments, because we're going to give them that helping hand to get them over there. Then we're going to move people from shelters to subsidized apartments. Then we're going to move people from the street to the shelters. Now, as opposed to simply building more shelters, which is what our current thing is. Now, you will hear people say the housing first model works. Now, this is you provide them a house, you provide them shelter, you give them an apartment, and you hope for the best. You say, hey, we have all these services available, but you don't deny them drugs and alcohol. You don't require them to do anything. And the success rate on this is like 12%, which, by the way, happens to be the same number as these down and outers. So they are helping those same people. They are providing that respite, if you will, for those people that don't want to be homeless, that might have a minimum wage job or a lower end job that need to get their act together. So, but one King County homeless thing housed one person at a cost of a $2 million program. Now, we are spending the money on homelessness. We're just not solving the problem, and we're actually growing the problem. We need to be putting those resources into putting people into homes. And my statement was, if we are simply building more apartments, we are warehousing people. We are not providing housing. We are warehousing those people. And everybody that lives in that apartment complex, 99% of them, want a home. And that's my goal, is to get them a home, get them a starter home.
If this all worked the way that you hope it does, you could see a person who is right now on the street homeless someday owning their own home. And not only that, owning their home, selling it and making that equity, that's the American dream, right? And then you just kind of continue that process. It opens up each step of the way, impacts both homelessness and housing. That's the name, from homelessness to housing, right?
That's right. So, I mean, that's the goal. And, you know, we have to, on the other side of the aisle, we are hitting these roadblocks. One roadblock is there's no evidence that denying them drugs and alcohol helps them. Now, how do you deal with that? How do you deal with that kind of attitude? I said, well, there's plenty of evidence that allowing them to continue on drugs and alcohol hurts them. I mean, we're putting people in hotels. I said, fine. If you're going to put people in hotels, and I missed one of the groups. One of the groups is elderly and disabled homeless people. I mean, they can't take care of themselves. They just need housing. Okay, so why don't we put those people in hotels? And after that, pregnant women with children, these people sleeping in their cars, put them in hotels. And then after that, if there is still room in those hotels and you have an able-bodied person, that person, and maybe that guy has a minimum wage job, they have to pay 25% of their income. If they make $100 a week, they got to pay $25. Everybody else in the world is paying 25 to 30% of their income for housing. So they should have to pay. If they don't have a job, then they got to do 20 hours of community service. I think Washington has the record for the amount of garbage on the side of our highways. You know, I mean, welcome to Washington and look at the garbage on the side of our road. So, I mean, people want, this country used to have a work ethic. People that were homeless didn't want to be homeless. You know, I cite the fact that there was a movie, My Man Godfrey. It was, Robert Powell, I think, is the actor. And he was living in a homeless camp in a garbage dump. And he made the statement, everybody in this garbage dump wants a job. If I went into a homeless camp now and said, who wants a job? How many people would I get? And we're undermining the work ethic. We have to reinstill that and say, we're not taking taxpayer dollars. We're willing to help you. We're willing to give you a boost. We're willing to get behind you and help you in your effort to get out of homelessness. But we're not willing to subsidize your drug and alcohol addiction. So, Other than that, I don't really have an opinion.
So when people say your approach isn't compassionate, you're saying, no, wait a minute. It's not only is it compassionate, but it also just adds a little bit of accountability. Is that kind of what you're looking for? I mean, you know, you hear from people all the time that this is not a compassionate approach. Do you have compassion for these people? I think from what I've heard you say today, yes, you do.
Well, when I got a hearing on the Shelter Act, in order to get a hearing on the Shelter Act, I had to remove the requirement, the misdemeanor thing, if you camped on public property after we did this at taxpayer expense, and I had to remove the requirement for drug and alcohol treatment. If we provided this shelter, you had to do drug and alcohol treatment. Even after that, 437 people signed in opposed to the bill. Now, who's more compassionate? Those people or me? I prefaced it. I said, this bill is not to solve homelessness. This bill is simply to get people off the street, off of public park, out of public parks, and off of sidewalks. And then here's what they said. It was creating concentration camps for homeless people. It was criminalizing homelessness. It was unfair to sex workers. I go, this is crazy stuff. And remember, you got to think about, I asked staff to come up with a number on how much money we're spending on homelessness. Now, that doesn't include this last biennium, the biennium before that, $2.7 billion. That's the state and all the counties, how much money they're spending, not including the cities. So if you add the cities into that, you're at $4 billion. Now, you could write everybody, every homeless person, a check for $250,000 and say, go away. You know, I mean, that's how much money we're spending on these programs, one after another. And they say my way isn't compassionate. And my response is their approach and what we are currently doing is certainly not compassionate.
That's Senator Phil Fortunato, and this is The Elephant in the Dome, the official podcast of the Washington State Senate Republican Caucus. I'm Tracy Ellis.